Good evening, and welcome to the Tuesday, November 14th meeting of the Cape Elizabeth School Board. If we could all rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic
for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have a few adjustments to tonight's agenda. First one being under new business item 11A, which is consideration of the superintendent's evaluation. That should read consideration of the superintendent's contract renewal. Secondly, we have a request to move item 11G, which is consideration of proposal for Cape Elizabeth High School sailing team. So we're going to move that to follow after item 4, before the comments by the high school and middle school students. And Anne, you have a request?
If we could add to 11F, a policy EFE competitive food sales to be considered for first reading. Oh, and I have one other one. If we could add a wellness committee report, which I don't think is on here, under policy committee.
Okay, I appreciate being reminded if I forget it, but I've got it here as far as the reports. We have approval of the school board minutes for October. Do I have a motion to accept them as presented in our packet?
So moved.
Thank you, Trish. A second?
Second.
Thank you, Rebecca. Any further comments regarding those minutes? Seeing none, all those in favor? We have 6-0. Communications, Alan.
Yes, I have a couple of, these are fairly quick ones. First one is Michael Fullen Workshop. If some of you have been following what's going on in education here in Maine right now, you know that Michael Fullen has been hired by the State Department of Education to come in and review the current mean learning results and the work they have been doing around assessment. Michael is an internationally known educator. He's come to us from Toronto, where he's been doing his most recent study. He is doing a workshop next week, and I, along with several others, are going to that workshop to get some sense of where are the next steps in the main learning results, in the assessment process, et cetera. So I'll bring back a much longer report after that has happened. But I just wanted you to know that it is a fairly small number of people who can go, and luckily some of us got into it. So we are going to go and hear what he has to say about the current movement. The second one I have is Maine State Board of Resolutions for 2006-2007. Really, the reason we put this in here is that the Maine State Board of Education each year does a series of resolutions as far as changes in planning and how boards operate with certain issues. The one that you have in front of you had resolution amendments to be adopted this year around board fiduciary responsibility, around essential programs and services, which is special education, and probably the most important one for you to read, because it is how guiding us in some changes within our special education programs. There's also the special education, the adverse effect standard, which also plays a role in that. And also the last one was TABOR, which was on this. You note this is dated November 6th. But the reason I give them to you is particularly 4.5 and 4.6 and the changes that will occur in the EPS and special education, so that you will have that information up front. And within the next month or two, Dominic will be here to begin to talk about some of the changes that he's looking at in special education itself as a result of both EPS and the special ed law.
Great. Any other communications at this time? Kevin, if you would like to speak regarding the Cape Elizabeth High School sailing team.
Yes, thank you. At the last meeting of the extracurricular activities meeting, Mike Siepert presented a proposal to the members of that committee regarding the sailing team. As a result of those discussions, it's met all the criteria that we usually put forward, including the budget criteria of no expense for the school. While the insurances are in place, travel arrangements, there is a secondary organization that would be under there that provides the sailboats and the sponsor for the regattas. Michael is here, and if anyone has any additional questions, we will be recommending that this be granted a club status as a club, as a sailing club versus team.
Okay. Good evening.
Welcome.
Thank you. I thank the board for having us here. As Kevin presented earlier, we put a proposal together. We've got currently six students at Cape Elizabeth High School who sail as part of a regional high school sailing team. This sailing team is made up of students from Greeley, Falmouth, Cheverus, Portland High School, Deering, the whole regional area. What we'd like to do is be able to separate these, use the same facility, same boats, but separate out our Cape Elizabeth sailors so they could actually participate in a few more events and actually represent Cape Elizabeth High School at the events as opposed to Southern Maine High School. Other advantages of that is that they would get credit towards the Maroon Medal, I believe, or hopefully as participation in a club or a sport. And I do have sailors on the team that they don't do any other sports or activities. They sail both fall and spring. So this would be a really big help for them as they go towards graduation. I had the proposal into the extracurricular committee. If there's any questions about the organization Sail Maine, Jeff Cummings, who is the sailing master, is supposed to be here tonight. I gave him 7 o'clock as a time here, but he's running a little late on his other duties. And he can answer any questions specifically about Sail Maine and how they fit into the mix with the team. I can certainly answer those questions. And here's Jeff actually right now. So, hi Jeff. So did you have any questions specifically? I know we talked about having to develop a contract between Cape Elizabeth School System and Sail Maine to allow our students to participate in an off-campus activity. Is that something that...
Do you have any concerns with that issue, Alan?
I don't. I was, of course, at the meeting that you had. You might want to just spend a couple of minutes explaining that so that board members do understand the process.
Okay. The process for what?
For the meets, how that all plays out.
Oh, okay. Sure. The team actually practices 4 days a week, Tuesday through Friday. Regattas or the meets are actually held on the weekends most of the time. Actually, if we organize Cape Elizabeth's team, we have the ability now to have a weekday event against Cheverus if we were to do a team race against Cheverus or against the Southern Maine High School team. Typically, in a regular dual meet regatta, you'll send 4 to 6 sailors to an event, and they'll sail 2 persons in a boat, A division and a B division. They'll go out and they'll rotate boats around, and they'll take a combined score for the team, and that's how they would actually participate in the event. Typically, you'll see, 16, 18 teams, 20 teams at an event, similar to a cross-country meet, I guess, where you have several students participating for a school and several schools represented at the meet. In the spring, it's very heavily weighted on the team racing thing where you actually put 3 boats of your team against 3 boats of another team. And that's really, it's actually a really exciting form of sailboat racing because there's a lot of rules that come into play. And as we're growing in the Portland area, I understand Falmouth is working on organizing their team. Portland is working on organizing their team. We'll be able to actually participate in more of these after-school team race events and then qualify our kids for other events throughout New England. Mount Desert Island has had a high school sailing team for 20 years. In the proposal packet I gave you, I had a letter from Griff Fenton there, and he just kind of described what their experience with having a sailing team and all the different aspects and points that sailing team brings to the high school. Any other questions about how the meets are run or how they're handled? Typically, we'll have a race maybe here at Sail Maine. We have one regatta which is over here. Are you familiar with the Train Museum? Okay, Sail Maine is located right on the waterfront right there by Portland Yacht Service. We have a big open event in the fall where we have 18 teams come in and they use our boats. We also did quite a bit of sailing with the team from Duxbury, down in Duxbury, Massachusetts. I had results from a race that the kids participated in Boston, which was a qualifying event for a national level event. And our kids actually did quite well. I highlighted that our scores, there was actually two students from Cape Elizabeth that participated in that. There was 20 teams at that event. So organizing as a Cape Elizabeth team really won't change an awful lot for how the kids daily go about their practice and everything else, but when it comes time to go to an event, we'll be able to go as Cape Elizabeth High School as opposed to one student amongst 35 in the Sail Maine or Southern Maine High School team. So it'll actually enable them to get to quite a few more events and to actually be able to represent Cape Elizabeth when they go.
I was really glad to see that proposal. I think it's exciting, and I appreciate you all making the effort to make that happen. I think it's a great addition to our athletic program.
I think it's wonderful, especially since half of our town is surrounded by water. I think it's a good sport to have, especially with all this rain lately.
Just trying to remember what the season is again. You say it's fall and spring.
Yeah, there's actually two seasons. The fall season runs from the beginning of September to the end of October. Okay. And then we'll start a spring season sometime middle to the end of March, depending on how brutal the winter is. And that'll go through the end of May. NESA, which is the New England School Sailing Association, they just had their annual meeting last weekend. And they've put together their scheduling for the spring events that I'll be able to hopefully be able to schedule our sailors for as they come up. So it's about an 8-week season, both ends. Mm-hmm. And then obviously the kids in the summertime, some of them participate in yacht club programs and other things.
I just would like to comment that I was there for your presentation to the co-curricular, and it was a very thorough and well thought out presentation. It answered, I think, every question that most of the school board could ever dream of.
Thank you.
So I appreciated that. And I just had one question, just because you mentioned that you do have some team members currently that don't participate in any other sport. As you're set up to be financially independent and you're be covering your own expenses, there's nothing in our school policy that requires them to pay an athletic fee over and above what they're paying Sail Maine. Is that correct?
Actually, that's an interesting question, Elaine, because there are other events that are self-supporting, like help. There he is, Jeff. Jeff, the two new clubs that we gave sanctioned earlier, I think one of them was a ski team.
Right.
Are they paying?
Yes, they are. But one of the reasons why, and we talked about it at the extracurricular committee meeting, one of the reasons why the proposal was to make this regular club, a school activity or a school club as opposed to an athletic club, is that kids who participate in extracurricular clubs don't pay them.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. The other thing on that, along those lines, it was not developed to exempt them from the fees. Rather, right now, the Maine Principals Association does not recognize sailing as a high school sport. Mm-hmm. And thus, they could not compete under MPA rules. Mm-hmm. Leaving them as a club, they can compete. And also fulfill one of their other things that is normally not acceptable to the MPA, which is multiple seasons, the spring and fall. So that's why we've brought this forward as a club versus a team.
I think they also had something about out-of-state competition also.
Right.
Some of our events actually are out-of-state in Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Connecticut. In the New England states, anyway. And then actually Chevis, was it Michigan, Jeff?
Michigan, yeah.
Chevis ended up qualifying for a national level event. They have two very, very high qualified sailors. And they went to Michigan last spring and competed there.
And because it's a competitive club sport, then therefore it becomes the students or the athletes fall under the contract.
Yes.
That we have with them.
Right.
So. Yes, the students, it was our intention and laid out at the meeting that everyone involved with this particular activity will be held to the standards of all school policies, rules, regulations, whether they emanate from the board or at the building level. So that's part and parcel of the club status.
Do we have any other questions?
Did anybody want to ask any questions specifically about Sail Maine and how they fall? Well, I've got Jeff here.
We're on the spot.
Why not? But he can certainly answer any questions about their organization. They do have available, I know one of the things that was questioned the extracurricular committee was the fact of paying a fee for students who are incapable of funding that fee, and it's I consider it a reasonable fee. I think it's a $350 or $400 for the season. $500 for both, okay. Sail Maine does actually offer scholarships or grants, I don't know what you... Yeah, to fund students who want to participate but can't afford the registration fee. So...
I'm just wondering if, Jeff, since you made the effort to come tonight, if you'd like to come up and just say a couple words, since you are here.
I'll step aside.
I'll come up with something. Thanks for having me here. Mike's done a fantastic job setting this up, been very thorough, and it's very exciting for us to help him through this process and support him in whatever way he might need. And certainly I'm available now and later if you should come up with questions further down the road. You can certainly get in touch with me and we can, I'm sure, quickly clear up any problem areas that might arise. Sail Maine's high school program was started with this in mind. The conglomerate team, which we call it, the Southern Maine High School Sailing Team, is designed to bring in any kids that have an interest in sailing, regardless of whether their school is able to or is interested in supporting it. When there sort of develops a critical mass, if there's enough students that are interested, then we're hoping that these schools will, you know, support the team on a team basis so that they can sail under their own flag, so to speak. And we're looking at three schools in that process right now in addition to Chevres, so that would be four right here in Portland alone. And that's great success as far as we're concerned. So we're just really happy to see it and happy to offer our facility and support. Any questions?
Thank you very much.
Thank, okay, you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.
Right.
Do you need any other?
I think we're all set at this point. If I could have a motion.
Yes, I'd like to move that the Cape Elizabeth School Board confer club status on the sailing team.
Is there a second? Trish? Any further questions or comments?
No.
Seeing none, all those in favor? 6-0. Thank you. We have item number six, which is comments from the public on any non-agenda items.
Comments.
Oh, high school, thank you very much, guys. Comments by high school and middle school students. If we could introduce them, I'm not familiar with the new students that we have as far as our representatives. Start with the middle school first. Don't you have your Steve come?
We have two representatives. I met with both today. I see one here right now, so I know the other one was delayed. Will Daly will probably be joining us. This is Michaela Ford, sixth grade student at our school. This is her first year, as you know, as a school board rep, and she has a lot of information to share.
Welcome, Michaela.
Thank you. The middle school girls cross country team completed their third consecutive undefeated season and fourth straight cross country championship. And the boys cross country team finished third in their championship meet and have a lot of returning runners. There were 40 girls and 30 boys that competed. In the middle school gym hallway, the seventh grade is painting fitness silhouettes. They're painting many topics in sports, such as sumo wrestling, sailboating, skiing, running, biking, etc. There's no school next week due to a Thanksgiving break, but there's a staff day Monday and Tuesday. The middle school fall play Lockers is a vignette set in present-day Cape Elizabeth. All of the characters are middle school students, and the performances will be Friday, December 1st at 2:30 p.m., Saturday, December 2nd at 7 p.m., and Sunday, December 3rd at 2:30 p.m. And that's it. Thank you.
Does anyone have any questions for Michaela today? Oh, you did a great job.
Thank you.
Thank you for filling us in.
Thanks.
Yeah, Michaela, do you happen to know anybody in the play?
They're
in the play. Okay. Yeah. Which vignette are you in?
The sneak out.
Okay. I've read this, but I'm not going to tip the hand. Some things that Will was going to talk about tonight. First of all, he was going to mention about the dance. We had our first school dance not long ago. Great turnout. Usually the gym has a large collection of students in the front half and then kind of dwindles off into open space in the back, but I would say it was a fairly busy place from front to back. And students were well behaved, dress attire and so forth were really good, so it was a nice night. And the kids asked from the student council, they said, well, you know, it was such a good start, how about we add a half an hour to the next one? So John Casey, Joe Doan and Jim Dolliner, who are the student council advisors, and Steve Neff, who's our next DJ, we've pretty much agreed to do that, so we'll shut the next one off at 9:30 instead of 9. And that dance, it says on our upcoming events, but we're updating that now, that it's on December 1st, and it'll actually be on December 8th from 7 to 9:30. Some of the other pieces about kids taking ownership of the facility, now you just mentioned which part on that, Michaela? What's the one that you have? Oh, the silhouettes in the hall?
Right.
Okay, so we're also working with a sculptor this year, Yiko Collier, who is going to be doing chicken wire and wood structures that are going to have poured concrete over them. They'll be in our courtyard area that goes along with our raised bed garden out there. We're also going to be adding glass totems in that space. We're going to turn it into instead of a place where you stake a goat out, we're going to turn it into our focal point for the school. So I remember my last year here was the first year of the reconstruction. I remember seeing somebody wheel a lawnmower down the hall one day. Where's this guy going? He's like, it's the only way to get there. So it's an interesting space, but has good use for us now. We're also, we have the new art display cases were constructed by Robert Rohner, who is Marguerite Lala Rohner's husband, the art teacher. And you should stop by and check those out. Three beautiful cases in our main hallway that we hope to turn into a perpetual permanent art gallery at our school of student work. So plenty of things going on that way. Special Olympics, we had 7 students recently participate in that at, I think it was at Vacation Land Bowling. I think that's the facility that it was at. And we had lots of kids come away with ribbons, and a good time was had by all. We had a total of we had 235 students just recently participate in fall sports. That's pretty busy. And that's, for instance, over 40 boys soccer players, over 40 girls soccer players, field hockey had over 30, football had over 38, and Michaela mentioned the cross country in the 60s. So quite a bit of involvement, and we certainly assume that we'll see that trend continue. So we're up over 70% of our 7th and 8th graders participating. We have a couple of fundraisers going on right now that we're doing for community service. The one that I'll mention here tonight is the Stuff a Bus that's being run by 100.9, the oldies, Chuck Igo. And that in the Stuff a Bus, they're looking for non-perishable food items. The pickup day for that is this Friday at 10 o'clock. anything non-perishable besides cranberry sauce. They said, we have two cabinets of cranberry sauce, or closets, so please, no more of that. But besides the non-perishable items, he also mentioned that if there are any monetary donations, an example would be that a collection of $320 would purchase 1 ton of food for the local pantries. So, any questions on those? Great. Thanks.
You did a great job, Steve. Yeah, thank you. We have some high school students this evening here.
Introduce one of our sophomores, Rosie Wenberg, who is going to be the school board representative with Jill Smith, I believe, who's a junior, and Daley Gruen may be making some cameo appearances every now and then, but neither of them were able to make it tonight. You got to know him last year. But Rosie has some good training in mock trial, being poised, standing in front of people, so not to raise the expectations too high, Rosie, but this is Rosie Wenberg.
Welcome, Rosie.
Oh, thank you. I'm a sophomore. I'm on the student council. And our school year started off well, and today we received our report cards from the first quarter. In September, we welcomed our new vice principal, Mr. Henninger, and a lot of other new staff members. We also made the fall sports season a success, especially in the cross country, where the boys placed first in the state and the girls placed in second. At the end of September, the junior class held a successful homecoming dance. And October was a month of standardized testing for us. The 9th and 10th graders took the NWEA tests, and the 10th and 11th graders took the PSATs. And November's been good, but it's been a little hectic because of the strange schedules that we've been on. And so the students are looking forward to next week's vacation. Recently, the SAC has been addressing the issue of limited senior privileges and cafeteria restrictions and the possibility of having actually a student representative on the school board. So that's what we've got so far.
Well, for someone who does not have children in high school, can you describe what the cafeteria restrictions are?
Recently, we feel like the student body in general has been feeling like we have been restricted in the cafeteria because I have an example is one time one of my friends forgot her money for lunch. She asked to go up to her locker, but she wasn't allowed to leave the hallways because we've been afraid that there's been disruption in the hallways for other classrooms, but we're just trying to work on making that a little bit more lenient.
Thank you.
So did she get to eat?
I'm sure somebody loaned her money.
Great. Any other questions? Thank you. That was great news. At this point, it looks like we're ready to move on to the comments from the public on any non-agenda items for this evening. Okay. I don't see any right now, so we'll move on to recognition. Al.
Yes. I have two recognitions of staff, or one permanent staff and one visiting staff that I'd like to speak about briefly. The first one is on Sharon Dorsey. Sharon is a teacher, a chemistry teacher at the high school. She recently received from her alma mater, University of Pittsburgh, the Distinguished Alumni in Chemistry Award. But I think what is interesting in reading about Sharon, I got to meet Sharon this summer. I've visited her classroom several times. I would say to you right up quick, she absolutely loves what she is doing. As a matter of fact, the last comment in the newspaper article is, I'm happy teaching, she said. I'll teach high school, God willing, until I am 70. It's just so enjoyable. But what she talks about is the fact that she's had a very broad range of experiences in her life. She talks about the fact that she has traveled across the country working with many different groups. She tells about in Louisiana there was a man she had to convince he could not contract AIDS from a vacuum cleaner, and how on the Arctic Circle she had met an electrician who thought beer and blubber were gourmet dining. And if you talk with Sharon, she has stories about all over the world where she has been. She's a lifelong learner. She chose this career because she felt passionately about the subject she studied. She said she has had the opportunity to travel, to do research, has even published some of her work. Her career has led her to work from ExxonMobil Oil Corporation, where she was an executive for them, to developing her own environmental health, safety, and industrial hygiene consulting firm in 1988. That firm, Eagle Environment Health Incorporated, has since merged with Environmental Resources Management, a London-based consultancy. Basically, she is a fascinating woman, an amazing addition to our teaching staff here. She was over to the office this morning, happened to run into her in the hall, and I mean, she just glows wherever she goes because she likes what she's doing so much. And so this award was a very deserving award for her and her history. This afternoon, I received an email from Sally Conley at the middle school, and I'd like to read it because I think it's important also. She starts it out with saying to me, in response to your request about news of classroom happenings, I am happy to write to you. Now here we go. Steve told me how to do this. Hiyori Fukagama? All right. Japanese artist who is spending most of her time in Marguerite Lawler Rona's class recently visited my two language arts groups. If you haven't been to the middle school and met her, she's another one who just loves what she's doing. She's got this big smile, and she's all over the place with people and doing all kinds of things. My students had just read The Big Wave by Pearl S. Buck. Through the book, they were introduced to some Japanese customs, style of dress, foods, etc. During her visit, Hiyori, who normally dresses in American-style clothing, was wearing a beautiful kimono with an obi sash. She explained that her kimono was casual, but one she'd wear to a wedding or a holiday celebration. Hiyori taught the children how to create a frog and a fish from origami paper. Everyone enjoyed this activity, and Hiyori is skilled at speaking English, and so she is good at caring for the students. Next, Hiyori taught the children how to correctly hold and use chopsticks. She presented each student with his or her own set of wooden chopsticks. Hiyori began her demonstration with a brief history of these utensils, explaining that they are sacred and were originally used to offer food to deities. She stressed how it is bad manners to use chopsticks as drumsticks, to stab food with them, to swirl them around in food, or to lick food from them. After Hiyori's lesson, the children tested their dexterity by trying to pick up flat marbles with their chopsticks. We at the middle school are most fortunate to have such an ambassador in our midst. Hiyori's visit coincides so nicely with the class novel my language arts students had just completed, and she helped bring the book to life. And that was written by Sally Conley. Again, a very nice tribute to someone who has worked at this point in time with us, doing some things with us.
Great. Sounds like we're very lucky to have all those individuals in our schools. Thank you for sharing that.
Okay.
Superintendent's report.
Before that, I have a special recognition.
Okay,
I'm not going to leave.
Good evening. First of all, what I would like to do is introduce two people who have just been elected to the board. I just want to welcome you, and that's Peter Carter, who is seated here, and Karen Burke, who is seated down back, and they will be inaugurated to the board on December 11th and have their first meeting December 12th. However, tonight, I want to talk about the current board. I want to talk about the current board for several reasons. I don't know how many people in the community recognize the enormous amount of work board members put into their work as boards. They are a seven-member board. As a seven-member board, they work together to make decisions for the school department and can concentrate their decisions on the fact that we are a place where kids should be receiving the very best education we can offer, and they do everything they can to make that happen. The board has many committees that are doing a great deal of work over and over again. The experience on the board, I hope at most times is enjoyable. There are times when it becomes pressure as certain events come up, but hopefully it's an enjoyable event for everyone. This evening, there are two board members who will be leaving us. This is their last official board meeting. We will have one more workshop meeting, and then they will go off to do their own things in the world out there, and I'm sure each of them has plans. But I'd like to speak about each one of them for just a moment. The first one is Elaine Maloney. Elaine was elected to the board in May of 2000. She took her oath of office and started her first term in June of 2000. Those are the days when elections were held differently than they are now. and she is currently completing her second three-year term. During her time on the board, she has served on the Finance Committee, a committee that anyone who has served in the Finance Committee knows is a great undertaking because it also involves all of the budget work that occurs. And one thing I would say right here about Elaine is Elaine always has the documents to prove what was done. If I can't find it anywhere else, I'll say, Elaine, do you have that? And she comes up with it. She served on the Planning Committee and Building Committees through the process of planning for and gaining approval for and completing the addition to the kindergarten and the renovation of the high school. I am more familiar with the renovation of the high school because I came right in the middle of it. And I remember walking into the high school when it certainly looked like a bomb went off in there because every place was torn completely apart. And I would find myself constantly going to Elaine and saying, okay, tell me what is going on, what is happening next, how do we make this all happen to open when time comes? And we did, amazingly. But it is important because one of the things I discovered, I had talked with many superintendents before I came here, knowing we had a renovation plan in place. And one of the things they often tell me is the ungodly work of renovation. What I found was because of the setup that had been made possible by the committee, with Elaine's help, and by the members of the school community, the process itself was a very streamlined process. We finished early, and we finished early because people were focused on what they were supposed to be doing. They met with us every Thursday to keep that focus going. Although Elaine didn't meet with us every Thursday, I could always go back to her and say, okay, I just heard this today. Now clarify for me, what is true? What do I need to remember, et cetera, which is always very important. She's also served the school board as representative to CEF, the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation. Again, as a new superintendent here, I had never heard of an education foundation for a public school. Cape Elizabeth has such a foundation. As you know, in recent months, they have raised $750,000 to help support the school system. But even more importantly, they are an organization that has very clear, concise goals, and those goals are supported by Elaine and members of the school community as they work together to make that happen. And it's an extremely important part of our school system. She has served as a school board representative to the town's Comprehensive Planning Committee. Elaine and I have had many conversations about that and attended a few meetings. It has been a very interesting process. It's been a very interesting process to be sure that the school department has a place in the report. She currently serves as chair of the school board, so that as in her last year here, she has overseen the work of the school board through, again, some times where we've asked to ask a lot of questions and had to make a lot of different changes. With a new superintendent on board, which is not always easy as we make those transitions. But above all, what I have found is Elaine has given her service in several key positions that has made valuable contributions to the school community. I could go on and on and on with that list. And I'm sure she could because I know she's been moving things around and sorting, so she knows what some of those are. So Elaine, if you could come up, please, for just a second. Elaine, our sincere thanks to you from the board, and I would also say this comes from the staff and everyone, and thanks for your time here. And hopefully this will be something you will enjoy greatly.
Oh, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll just be short. I just want to say I really, really loved working with all of you. I mean, past superintendents and teachers and students, and I've learned so much about education and the challenges and the special rewards that education provides for all of us. I say congratulations to Karen and Peter. I wish you the very best with the new board and hope that you can continue the great work that all these people have done for the students in our town. So thank you, and I really will miss the meetings, and I will miss the people. I can't imagine going so cold turkey, but I'll be watching.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Secondly is Ann Belden. Now, I do have to tell a little story about Ann. Prior to my even knowing I was coming to Cape Elizabeth when I was in another district, I was going to a doctor for some work, and he happened to say to me, you know, I know you're a superintendent in a school district, and my wife is thinking about running for the school board. What do you think about that? And I thought, oh, I better be careful what I say. So I said to him, I think she will thoroughly enjoy it. It'll give her many challenges, but again, the most important challenge of all is to do what you can for young people and students. And one thing I've learned about Ann very clearly, she has a very, very, very strong feeling about what happens with students in the school system. She's worked with the middle school to get some programs started. She has worked throughout policy work to make sure that we are always keeping our focus on the students. Ann was elected in May of 2003, and she took her oath of office and started her term in June of 2003. Again, a little different time for elections. So she's completing her three-year term as a member of the school board. She has served as the vice chair of the board for the last 2 years. She has served on several committees and made significant contributions to each. Obviously, the one that I can speak to most clearly is the policy committee, because Ann knows, as does the board, and certainly as I know, the policy is the most important survivorship of the school system, because it is basically the rules and regulations that operate the school system. Policy had become quite old and needed to be renewed, went through the process of working with our lawyers and Main School management to decide what to do, and then began the actual work. And it has been a lot of work. Ann and I have had many conversations. She'd been working on it prior to my coming and has continued to do it. As of this week, or as of this time, we now have a school board policy book which is in one volume, which is wonderful since I had three in my office and it was hard to keep track of them all. And we've also moved policy to our website, which is, again, extremely important for people to get reference on it. The work that she has done has spearheaded many changes, many reviews of where we're going. And because we're now in the 21st century, begun to look at things that are different in education today than it was 20 and 30 years ago and how we manage that. This huge undertaking will continue on. I don't think any of us will ever survive the day when the policy book is done, because once it's done once, you got to turn around and do it all over again. It does reflect state law, it reflects federal law. And so I can't thank Ann enough for the enormous amount of time and energy she's put into that work. We just had a policy committee meeting today, as a matter of fact. And also, as her work as chair of the policy committee, several subcommittees have resulted from that, which have been extremely important. Probably the one that most people read about in the newspaper over and over again was the substance abuse subcommittee. And it was one that took about a year to do, but it was excellent because every faction was heard. Students were able to be heard, staff was heard, administration was heard. It took some time to debate our way through these, but through Ann's direction and Trisha's chairing of that committee, an enormous amount of work was done and a very important policy resulted. There was the Food Allergy Committee, which was just before my time, which has also took a very close look at what goes on in the schools around food allergy and foods and how we deal with the allergic reactions to different types of foods. The most recent one is the Wellness Committee, and Ann will speak about that tonight, as a matter of fact, when we get into the policy section of our agenda. But I think, although the focus here has been on policy, what I would say again is Ann has taken an interest in possibilities. She's very interested in student voice. We still, as a board, will be doing more work on that, and hopefully she'll come back to help us with some direction with that. So those are all important pieces for us. So Ann, again, we would like to thank you for your time, and if you could come up, please. Ooh, thank you. On behalf of the school board and the staff, I would like to thank you very much. And again, I hope you enjoy this. I think it will be something you like very much.
Yeah.
Well, I was hoping this... I was going to say, I was sort of hoping that this was a gold-plated policy manual.
I'm working on it.
But I don't know. It doesn't look like that. I'll just say that I was thinking today about my very first school board meeting 3.5 years ago. And I can't remember one thing that was on that agenda, but I can remember how I felt that day and that night. And I will first say that for the two new board members here, it's a heavy load sitting on the other side of this dais. I mean, I think I've probably like shrunk an inch, and I can't really afford that, so that's a problem. But I remember sort of first having to get through the deer in the headlight feeling, like when that on-air light comes on and, you know, the lights come on and all that stuff. I remember taking a big gulp and thinking, oh my gosh, was I sure I really wanted to do this? And after I sort of moved beyond that, I started to think about all of my fears came through, you know, and am I going to say something stupid? Am I going to say anything at all? What if I make a motion and it doesn't come out right? There's a lot of things that go through your mind when you're like trying to pay attention, and all those little insecurities start to float to the surface. Somehow I managed to get through that, and what I finally settled into and what I think I've kind of tried to maintain my 3.5 years is sort of a sense of my internal compass and just really listening to people and really trying to do the right thing, what I feel is the right thing. And listening to the kids' voices, listening to the parents, to the teachers, and it's hard to do that sometimes, but for the most part, I feel that I have pretty much had that compass pointed at true north. And really, it has overwhelmingly been a sense of real honor and pride to sit up here and do the best job that I can do. And hopefully I walk away tonight feeling that, you know, if I've given the community as much as I feel like I've gotten out of it, it's been a real great success for me. So thanks, everybody.
Now I'm done.
Thank you, Anne. Thank you, the rest of the board. We'll move along. For the superintendent's report now.
Okay. Just again, three fairly quick items. First of all, the View, the school's newspaper, has come out. I have not seen a final copy
it's
of
upstairs.
It yet. I have some upstairs. I had seen the pre-printed copy several times. It is shorter than usual because we wanted to do two this year. And so this one has really tried to have a real focus on some of the things going on in our schools. And then we'll do another one in the spring, which will have a focus on where Cape Elizabeth schools are at that point and where we are aiming for in the next steps along the way. Again, it is, this process takes quite a while. It's getting articles in, it is proofing them, it is merely collecting them and then having to recheck them and then send them back out to have them checked one more time before the final printing is done. And not this past Saturday, but the Saturday before, I spent quite a bit of time here in the office as we got that final edition ready to go. So I am pleased that it's out. I hope you've enjoyed it. I would also mention that on a week before last, is that right, 2 weeks ago? Maine School Management held their annual fall conference. I was able to go to part of it. I had some commitments here in the system, so couldn't get away for all of it. And I know Trish went to a part of it also, and I know Karen Burke also attended. I would mention that what this conference is made up of is of meetings which talk about education from the classroom point of view, from the school system point of view, and a lot of board members are also there. I know that Karen and I attended one meeting which was done by Kennebunk in Kennebunkport, where they talked about meetings that they have with staff members and eventually with the public, which really opens the door for some interesting conversations. I also went to a Tabor meeting that day. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that. I don't think we need to revisit that at this point. But I did spend the time at the Tabor meeting. And I don't know, Trish, if you want to speak about the one that you went to, or one or two.
I actually went to two briefly. One of them was about the Maine Learning Results realignment more. Because it was actually 10 years ago that the Maine Learning Results was originally created. And it's now sort of being realigned with some of the national assessment and standards. And I went to a second one, which was just so great. It was really thought-provoking, and it was presented by three schools that are receiving money through the Gates Foundation, and it's Maine Schools for the 21st Century. And they talked about some of the initiatives they have to help all students succeed, and sort of how, you know, they talked a little bit about tracking, not tracking, how they use data, their leadership teams, how they listen to voices from all the people in the community. So it was just, it was really interesting, and I really came away with some things to think about.
Thank you. I should mention, with this report, the communications committee that Rebecca chairs, one of the things that we've decided to do is put a site on our school website, which will contain brief reports on some of these things. And I think she's going to speak about it further later. But I just wanted to bring it up while we had this moment to do it. The last thing I'll mention is budget planning. As I learned as a superintendent, that I knew as a principal but have learned very clearly, budget planning is probably the longest, most in-depth, sometimes the most frustrating, also can be interesting process. We are now in that process. I waited until Tabor and the decision of what was going to happen with Tabor. We have now started the process with the administrators have been asked to put together a budget which currently focuses on the current levels of functioning and how much it would cost to maintain status quo. Status quo last year was a 7.7% budget, and so it will be something like that again this year. I'm very cognizant of the fact that I build that budget and that we will have a lot of work to do between there and when the final budget is passed by the town council. But we are in that process. One of the things we're doing, and you might have read an article again by Rebecca, I think, did one on zero-based budgeting. So one of the pieces we're looking at is all sections of our budget, taking a look at them from the perspective of what's working for us, what doesn't work for us, what changes might we need to make. We're very clear that right now, based on the information that we have, that if we went by October to October CPIU rate, it would be 2.1%, which is about half of what it was last year, which will be therefore a fairly small percent increase if the town council stays with the CPIU spending limit. We have looked at the budget and recognize that 2.1% will not come anywhere near meeting the $1 million of commitments that we have to salaries, fringe benefits, course reimbursement, et cetera. So we are beginning the process. Rebecca is currently the chair of the Finance Committee. I will be presenting to the Finance Committee after the vacation, and shortly thereafter, just as soon as Christmas is over, I will meet with all administrators to begin to take a look at budgets and look at the direction we're going in. But the process has started. So for you two new board members out there, just wanted you to know that we are working down the road for that. And that is my three reports for today.
Well, thank you, Alan. A school report. Tonight, we have the honor of having Joanne Paquette here to speak with us regarding the science program at the middle school. Welcome, Joanne.
Hi, thank you for having me. I don't think I had a choice. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Joanne Paquette. I'm a seventh grade science teacher at the middle school. And I was approached at the end of last year by Mr. Conley to be the lead teacher for the science program at the middle school 5, 6, 7, and 8. And I knew it would be big shoes, but I have big feet. What I'd like to share tonight is the direction that I've taken and what we are planning to go, what's been done and where we're planning to go. As you know that we need to continue to improve our science program to get our kids ready for the international market that's out there. One thing that we're looking at is the writing program at our school, and we've seen that there's one gap with the kids taking the lessons that they learn in their language arts classes and carrying them over in the content areas. So we would like to have our higher expectations for what we're accepting in the content area of science. across the board. We also have met with the high school science department chair, Doug Worthley, and we're talking about, he just sent us his lab reports, and we're going to try to be more of a feeder program into the high school as far as what their content area is. We'd also like to try to do that starting at a lower age level of fifth grade at some degree and work our way and improve on those 5, 6, 7, and 8. Also with also current events and getting them involved in that and writing summaries and things like that and research projects. The other thing we talked about with Mr. Worthley is to get a criteria for students who are going to go into the AP classes in high school. How do we make that recommendation? Maybe coming up with more indicators besides just teacher recommendations. So we're going to work on that. And we've already met once for that. The other thing that I'm going to undertake is aligning 5, 6, 7, and 8. Each of the areas that we do teach, biology, physical science, earth science, and take the concepts for the benchmarks and try to touch upon them and grow upon them at each grade level. We already started a lot of the mapping previously, so I'll start with that. What have we, has everybody done? We've identified the gaps that we have and the strengths, which we do have many of those too. And go through our previous prioritization that the science teachers went through. Where is our priority as far as teaching science? And start there. So an example would be if we were to teach density in fifth grade, they may not label it, but they might do sink and float. And then in sixth grade, they'll also get another portion of density. In seventh grade, they may use the formula. In eighth grade, they'll use, you know, just a higher level of that and get that concept every year. One of the things that I'll be using is the Atlas of Science Literacy, which I do have here if anybody's interested in seeing, is strand maps. And those were sanctioned by the National Science Teachers Association and the Advancement of Science. And it just takes all the contents from the benchmarks, and it will just say at what age level has it, you know, is it beneficial for them to be introduced to some concepts, and then to spiral it and get back to it every year as they go through that. Let's see. Professional development. I will be going to a course with another eighth grade teacher. As you know, we have a lot of new science personnel this year, which is a great time for us to be really talking about new things and new energy. And we'll be spending 3 days working on this mapping. And so we'll start doing that curriculum at the middle school. The other thing is the real life experiences that we think that's important, that science isn't just isolated. It should, you know, be real things, their questions, getting them interested, and then trying to find a way to answer them. The laptops is a great resource for those answers to be quickly answers. And also field trips, get them out in the field and doing real science, what real scientists do. And the assessments, we want to also make sure that we match what we're doing with the MEAs are requiring, what we have to do with them, and the SAT issues that come up. And we'll look at all of that and see how can we get a solid curriculum and to get them prepared for that. And the last would be the budget. If we could just take the budget, pool our resources, you know, and then as we're going along, you know, if we need to have some sort of a budget to provide that education that we come up with, which has to be good. Any questions? Hello.
First, thanks for coming, even if it was under duress. We're glad you're here.
I noticed he didn't have to say anything. It's like I took his place.
I think it's so great, because I've been asking this all along, why don't we talk more? I think it's great, first, that you're talking to the high school. I think it's wonderful. You have the opportunity, the good fortune of being in the middle. It's great that we're looking to the high school. Is there a plan to sort of see, are the fourth graders who come to your fifth grade science teachers, do they have the skills they need? Is there a plan for those two schools to talk?
Absolutely. There's not one in place right now, but that's on the, it should be K through 12. And we used to have a science committee, and I was on that before, and we used to talk about those issues and those things, so I would say at some point, yes.
Thanks.
I can only do so much.
You said you were reviewing priorities, what grade level, what needed to be taught. When do you think that analysis will be? I mean, you never complete it, but this first round, when do you think you'll have kind of reached a conclusion as to what grade should be teaching what aspect of each science course? This year, another year? The reason why I'm asking is...
answer that. I'm going to try my hardest. Right now we're working with fifth grade, as you know, and we're going to, you know, start with one curriculum strand, which is oceanography, in place of the Voyage of the Mimi. We're not really changing the importance of oceanography. We just changed some of the resources that are used for that. So we'll start with oceanography as one of those things, and then the contents will go along with that, and we'll build upon that. So that's where I'm planning on starting right now.
So there's no sort of general sense of a timeline about how long this is going to take?
I will speak to it from my perspective anyway, is that this is a beginning, because we, I think Joanne said it very clearly, is this is an excellent time to be doing this because of the change in the middle school staffing. I also talked with Doug a long time the other day, and I would like to say to Joanne that I thank her. He was so excited about having the types of conversations he's had with the middle school. Mm-hmm. So I think those changes are going to come. I think some of the things that Joanne and that group are going to be looking at is the types of science. There are a lot of theories out there about how you teach science and whether you teach all science, pieces of all sciences every year, mm-hmm. or teach a specific science every year. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's a piece that is going to be coming with Doug and Joanne and the groups, from my understanding and talking with Doug. The other day at the football game, so you know, I'd like to do, I had a chance to talk with him there. I think the other thing that I should mention is we did talk about the elementary schools as well, and how eventually that will be a progression. Yeah. But we knew that we have been doing some struggling in the past with science, number one, because of the change in the main learning results, and number two, with some of the resources that we have. Yeah. And so I thank Steve from the perspective of being able to move Joanne and one of his other teachers, at least one, into a place where they can have one period where they do work with the staffs across the schools to begin to open the questions and concerns.
Well, Joanne's in a very limited role in that respect because she's freed up one period a day. So there's only so much in a 40 some odd minute period that you can do. But what we're doing is, in our staff meetings, we're having regular, we're splitting the time. There are content conversations that go on during half of those staff minute meetings. And we're also using any of the district days that we have. We're making sure we get groups together to continue conversations. And we're going at it not just from what the topic is, like the oceanography or density or something, but we're looking at it from a conceptual framework, such as what are the actual concepts that we want those vehicles to help us get across to kids. So we're going to map out the concepts as we're moving. Now the tough part for us is that we're building it as we're flying it. It's just part of the nature of education. It's the way it works. If we could just say to Joanne here, take a year off and will you work on this and let us know what you come up with, that'd be great. But as it is, the fifth grade is going through about a third of the program this year in a renovation. And in the eighth grade, I'd say it's more like half the year is being renovated, so substantial renovation in that grade. Seventh grade's looking really good, and this is one of the primary authors of that right here. And the sixth grade curriculum's in very good shape as well. We need to articulate those concepts. We're going to create a matrix from those so that we'll be able to look down through and say, when do kids hit these certain things? Which ones are we hitting too much, or which ones aren't we hitting? And this atlas, this huge, it looks like, I told her, I said, open it up, pretend you're walking down from a mountaintop and say, oh, look, there are 11 of these, not 10. And so the mind maps in this are just incredible. She's going to be going to some training for that, and I'm glad it's her, not me. I'd love to take the time, but she's in the classroom doing this work and knows how it impacts students, so very
and
fortunate.
Then we can look back and we'll say, you know, you had this in sixth grade and you had it in fifth grade and this is how it builds, because it's, you know, they really believe it's developmental, but they may, you know, look back and say, okay, that's why we did that. So if we all know what everybody's doing and have that on paper, I think it will help everybody, the teachers and the students.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Very much. Yes.
I'm just going to interrupt for 1 minute. I missed one thing under recognition. I had asked Jeff and Steve both to bring information about their athletic programs and how they've done. Steve's was done by his student, but Jeff, do you have your information to do that also? I'm sorry, I forgot that as we went through.
I think you've got the actual printed list, Alan, but check these off and make sure I get them all. I think I've got them. We had a lot of students involved in our athletic program. One of the interesting things that's come out of the fact that all students are now required by the new school board policy, substance abuse policy that was worked on, to attend one of these meetings during the course of the years, we have a much better handle on not just the number of students who are participating or planning to participate in athletics, but the number who are planning to participate in extracurricular activities as well. Our last, I hope, scheduled meeting for that is tomorrow night, actually. And I'm expecting, and I think I actually reported about in the State of the School report a couple weeks ago, that by the end of that, I think we're going to have 85% of the students and parents attending one of these sessions. The sessions have evolved. So if you were lucky enough to go to the marathon first one, they have gotten considerably shorter and I think more sort of focused on what we need to accomplish. And the lines have gotten shorter as well. So it's been an interesting evolution. But we have had a successful fall athletic season. And I'll just mention each of the teams, the girls field hockey team and the girls soccer team, both had good seasons and both made it into the playoffs. Not very as deeply into the playoffs as they would like to make it, but they made it into the playoffs, which is an accomplishment. The boys soccer team surprised a couple of teams in the playoffs and beat Deering, and then most gratifyingly beat Greeley on Greeley's home field, which was great. Unfortunately, we lost to a very strong Scarborough team, but the boys soccer team did make it into the Western Maine semifinals, which is a strong accomplishment for them. Our football team had the longest season, and what is particularly noteworthy about the great accomplishments of the football team is that, as people have read about in the newspaper, it's only the second year that Cape Elizabeth High School has had a Class B football team. So it's amazing to be able to report that they were the runner-up in the Western Mains this year, because that's just a huge, huge accomplishment. And to think about what the football program was a few years ago and what it is now, and the pride that those guys walk around the school wearing the football jerseys and what that means, it's actually quite amazing. Golf. Our golf team is always successful, and they were the runner-up in the States this year, which is a great accomplishment for them. They wished that they'd been able to beat Falmouth. They fell a little bit short, but hopefully next year they'll be able to pull that off. Girls cross country had an outstanding team, outstanding season, and they finished second in the States this year. And the boys cross country team had the greatest accomplishments of all our athletic teams. They finished first in the States in the Class B, and they then went to the New England meet in Manchester, New Hampshire last weekend, I think it was, and they finished third of all the schools throughout New England. And that is the highest that any Maine team in history has ever performed in the New England meet. So that's a huge accomplishment by our boys cross country team, and what dedication and teamwork that group has shown over this year. It's been fun to watch them. That's my report. I hope I got them all, Alan. Okay, very good.
Oh, I'm glad we didn't miss that. Thank you, and congratulations to all the students and athletes from all the teams for the fall sports season. Mm-hmm. So we'll return back to our regular agenda. We are now moving on to unfinished business. A, policies for a second reading.
Okay, there are three policies in your packet for second reading. The first is IKF graduation requirements. And there are no changes on this from last month when we had our first reading. So I'd like to make a motion to accept IKF as presented here.
Second. Thank you, Rebecca. Any questions or comments? All those in favor of IKF as presented? I'm sorry, do we have six? Thank you. 6-0.
The next one is IMBB, which is accommodation of sincere beliefs and required instruction. And again, there are no changes in this from the first reading. So I'd like to make a motion to approve IMBB as presented here.
Second?
Second.
Thank you, Linda. Any further questions?
think we want to actually put the name of Cape Elizabeth in there instead of name of school unit.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, thanks for pointing that out. So can we just add that, make that change and to my motion?
Mm-hmm. So all those in favor of the amended motion? 6-0. Thank you.
And the last is IMG, Animals in Schools, and there are no changes to this policy from the first reading. I'd like to make a motion that we approve IMG as presented.
Great, second. Thank you, Trish. Any comments on Animals in Schools? I won't go there. Okay. All those in favor? 6-0. Under new business, item number A is consideration of the superintendent's contract, and I just want to take a moment before I turn this motion over to Linda from Personnel and say that at our last business meeting, we had a presentation regarding the superintendent's evaluation, which was something that the board is charged to do on a yearly basis. It had been two or three years since the board had done a full evaluation on any superintendent. We had had some interims, we had an outgoing superintendent, and we also had the establishment of a new personnel committee, which was then charged with developing the tool that we used for the evaluation. So that we took a look at the actual tool, we requested that the personnel committee make a few adjustments, and we did conduct an evaluation with that tool with Alan over the last couple of weeks. I just want to say that I thought it went incredibly well. The board learned a lot about the success that Alan has had. We opened it up to all of the staff at the Cape Elizabeth schools for some feedback. We also heard from our district leadership team, and at that point, we have shared all the responses with Alan, and it is a formal evaluation tool. Meanwhile, the personnel will be coming up with a timeline for the future process and how that ties in with the state requirements about renewing a contract, which we're going to be doing this evening, and how it also ties in with the rehiring of a superintendent and their evaluation. So with that, I'll turn it over to Linda.
In accordance with Maine State Law 20A, subsection 1051, number 2, I move that the Cape Elizabeth School Board elect, with appropriate financial commitment, the Superintendent Alan H. Hawkins for a full term beginning July 1st, 2007 and extending until June 30th, 2009.
Do I have a second?
Second. Oh, sorry. Go ahead, Trish.
Third.
Thank you. Do I have any other questions or comments on the motion? Seeing none, all those in favor? 6-0. Consideration of the superintendent's recommendation for athletic fee positions for winter 2006-07.
Okay. I'd just like to comment quickly. I see Scott sitting there to speak on one of the policies that we have around wellness. So we are getting there, just so you won't think we've lost it. First of all, from Keith Weatherby, the coaching recommendations for returning winter coaches for 2006-07. They are Jim Ray, who will be in his 20th year as the varsity boys basketball coach. Jerry McQueeny, a seventh year as JV boys basketball. Chris Haywood, third year as freshman boys basketball. Doug Worthley, 11th year as varsity indoor track. David Weatherby, fourth year as assistant indoor track. Paul Snyder, fourth year as assistant indoor track. Ben Raymond, 12th year as varsity girls and boys swim. Mike Bartley, third year as diving coach. Devin Morrill, fifth year as varsity Nordic ski. Jason Tremblay, third year as ice hockey coach. Joseph Robinson, third year as assistant ice hockey coach. Eric Wersing, second year as assistant ice hockey coach. And Mike Miller as third year assistant Nordic ski. Also new winter coaching recommendations are Todd Plummer, first year as varsity girls basketball level 3, and Sunshine Anders, first year JV girls basketball, level three. Those are the ones from the high school.
Do I have a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendations?
So moved.
Thank you, Rebecca. Second. Thank you, Linda. Any further comments?
You know, questions? I do. I just want to thank all of these people for agreeing to serve as coaches. I know it's a lot of work, and oftentimes it's challenging, and I just want them to know that it certainly doesn't go unnoticed from the school board and also as a parent. So thank you to everybody who's agreeing to coach.
Thank you, Rebecca. All those in favor? We have 6-0.
I have two middle school coaching positions. The first one is Tony Jones as 7th grade boys basketball coach, and Joe Doan as 8th grade boys basketball coach.
Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Kevin. A second?
Second.
Thank you. Any questions regarding the middle school athletic recommendations? Very lucky to have those two individuals.
That's right.
All those in favor? 6-0. Consideration of the superintendent's recommendations for co-curricular fee positions for the 06-07 school year.
Okay, I have three for Cape Elizabeth High School. One for Cape Elizabeth High School and two for the middle school. I have the high school, it says art club, but there's no person's name there, so apparently that hasn't been filled yet.
Oh, I'm sorry, it was supposed to, I apparently got interrupted and didn't get the name put in there. What's her name?
Sarah Collins.
She has done it for the last few years. Her name's Sarah Collins.
Yes. Okay.
I apologize.
And department head research coordinator is Joyce Bell.
Yeah.
At the middle school, SAT representative is Deborah Hannon. And fifth grade math team coach is Allison Caruso, who is replacing Adam Killam. Is that correct?
Do I have a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendations?
So moved.
Thank you. Second. Thank you, Rebecca. Any questions for Alan regarding these positions? Seeing none, all those in favor? 6-0. Consideration of the a request regarding community services proposed trip for the summer of 2007.
Okay. This is one from Susan Dana, the Spanish teacher. Normally, I go over these beforehand to go over them with you. Unfortunately, I have not had a chance to do this, and it's cut on the side, so I can't read it all. So Susan is there. If it would be all right, I'd like to ask her to come up and speak to it this time, although we don't normally do that.
Okay,
and Sue Weatherby as well.
Susan approached community services in September after thinking about this for quite a while and talking to advisor, advisee, kids in the program. Wouldn't it be great to offer a trip such as this? And because it's a summertime offering rather than a school year offering, and it fits well with our capability camp philosophy, although it's a little different in that this would be a service project, but we felt it was appropriate to run it through community services. So Susan's done the legwork to this point, and what we are looking for tonight is permission to just proceed and see what the interest is out there. So I'm going to turn it over to Susan.
Thank you. I'm Susan Dana, Spanish teacher at the Cape Middle School. Did you receive this in your packets? So I don't really know how much, I'll just give you a brief introduction, but this is something I've wanted to do for quite a few years, and my advisory groups for the past 2 years have raised school supplies for this particular program, which is in Guatemala City. It's called Safe Passage, Camino Seguro in Spanish. What's interesting, I think, about this program is that it was founded by a Maine native. They just opened an office now in Yarmouth, Maine. And it's a program that's been around since 1999. And what this, the purpose of this program is it provides the children of Guatemala City, poor children who live in the Guatemala City dump, provides them with after-school enrichment. It is not a school. It's a program that provides enrichment and support for these children. It provides access to medical care, provides them with school supplies, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, there's a lot more information I could give you, but essentially this would be a mission trip for our students. I really would like to, I think our program has been around since 1988, our FLESS program, and I think we have a very strong program, but I think we're at the point now where we need to try to move on, and I'd really like to see us have the students use the language in a really practical use. I think it's a great community service project. Students have actually approached me last spring when we collected the school supplies. We collected about 13 boxes, which I delivered to Safe Passage up in Yarmouth. And they said, gee, is there any way we could ever go? And I said, well, let me think about it. So I thought about it over the summer, and I really would like to try to pursue this with the students. Not taking middle school students, but taking students grades 9 through 12. I think I'm going in June. I know that students in this town especially have preseason in August. A lot of them go away to summer camp. So I thought if we went right after school, June 23rd, taking into account we might have 5 snow days there, this is still, we're safe. But a 10-day trip, and I have spoken with a teacher from Deering who took students and also someone from Brunswick. I will say I have not been to this particular site. I've been in contact with them quite a bit, but I do have some really good references from local teachers who have taken groups down. As I mentioned here, Guatemala City is, like any city, you do have to be careful. We'll be working in Guatemala City in the day and staying in Antigua, which is an hour away from Guatemala City. And the Safe Passage actually owns a hotel, which I think we could stay there. It's possible to have a home stay, but I think where this is my first time, I'd rather have students. We're all together, we're in the hotel. As I've mentioned in the packet, safety would be stressed definitely ahead of time and all throughout the entire trip. And that's what both the teacher from Brunswick and from Deering High had stressed, that they had absolutely no problems, but right from the very beginning, the very first meeting, they stressed the importance of safety and staying together as a group. So I just want to be upfront about that, but I think we can definitely handle it. Many groups have gone. They have quite a few groups from Northern Europe that go, Scandinavian countries. And they've had numerous groups go very successfully. So I don't want to open it up to questions. I don't want to take too much time, but I'm very excited about it. Students are still asking me. I haven't even told them that I'm going to be here tonight. 2 students know because they've just been emailing me all the time. I said, okay, I'm presenting it tonight. Let's see. But I don't know if there are any other questions.
She had a question. Did she get that answered?
Do we have any questions for Sue and Susan?
Did you have a question?
I feel like a broken record. Not on the trip, I think it's wonderful. I guess my question is, if it's taking place in the summer, does the school board need to approve this?
I have exactly the same question, Alan.
I did actually, when I saw it, I did go back to our policy, trying to practice what we preach. I guess it's because it's international, I don't know if that impacts it, but I thought our approval was if a student misses a school.
Or part of the curriculum.
When you did the trip to, your people did the trip to Europe.
Yes.
During the summer, what happened at that point in time?
We brought it to the school board just for approval to go. We did buy trip insurance, although because it's a community services activity, it's not school, but it falls under the school department umbrella. So we've always brought it forward. Whether or not it needs to be voted on by the board, I don't really know the answer to that.
I mean, we definitely appreciate knowing about that. I think when we struggled over this field trip policy and sort of what needed to come to the board and what didn't, we certainly said we wanted to know about these things, and we clearly appreciate all the information and the detail to sort of do our homework. I guess it's
one of the things I do when we offer our capability camps in the summer, and we do offer these adventure trips, I send complete trip itineraries to MMA, and I always have done that, just so that they have something on file saying we are doing this.
So then I guess one of the questions would really be, you know, so which of the trips that community services does will we be approving and which will we not? Because I know you do several.
The only ones we've really brought here are the ones where we've left the USA.
Mm-hmm.
The European trips, and we've been there twice now. We brought both of those trips to the board. This one would be falling into that category, having left.
And so then would that mean that all the other trips, then the schools would not be liable for, should there be, you know, some kind of problem?
Well, they're community services programs,
which
so it would mean that the town of Cape Elizabeth or the school department would be liable in terms of it comes under that umbrella, even though it's not during the school year. I believe we've been asked to send it to MMA. We do, so we wouldn't need to do that if it weren't considered with some affiliation with the school. So
I don't know the answer.
It
points up, I mean, it's a great example of, you know, when you're developing a policy, you know, and we spent months on the student travel and field trip policy, as you may remember, that you just can't foresee, you know, every aspect of a, you know, potential travel situation.
And I think we went through that. Was that my first summer? Yeah, it must have been my first summer here, when you had the group in Europe and there had been bombings. Am I correct?
Right.
Yes.
And even though it was through PACS, I mean, through the community services, certainly you and I spent an enormous amount of time making sure where kids are, that they were safe, et cetera. And I think it went back to the insurance question. That's not the way I like to look at it, but it did go back to the insurance question and the responsibility the school system with the town holds in that situation if something had happened. And so I agree. I think these are hard ones because it is what part of this do we hold as a school system, and these are kids coming out of our school system.
And, you know, looking at the policy right now, I mean, if we're saying that all trips that are through community services do in fact come under the auspices of the school system, then according to our policy, anything that's over 125 miles would have to come to the school board. And so maybe at this point that's
the piece that probably.
Right, that's what should be followed. Carried forward in terms of.
No, go ahead. I'm listening.
I mean, if that's what we're saying, that any community services trip does.
Do we say that in the policy?
See, it doesn't really specifically speak to. It doesn't break out community services versus any.
The way I'm looking at this is, we don't need to vote on this, and that doesn't stop the trip. The policy we adopted specifically exempted trips that were not taking place during school time. And although this is, you know, unusual, it's not unheard of, and it's simply just, you know, the bottom line is go on the trip. I think it's a great idea. I think it's a great experience for the kids, but I don't think it needs to be blessed by the school board.
But then I think we just have to be really clear that the schools are not, in any way responsible.
We can always amend the policy to embrace that, but the way the policy is written tonight, after all the time and effort and energy trying to straighten it out, I think we need to adhere to the policy.
Yeah, but I'm not sure that it really spells out one way or the other. I mean, it could be interpreted either way, actually.
Well, see, I don't like interpretation. If it's in black and white and it says what it says, you know.
I guess it depends on how we perceive services.
I think your question, though, is a question. We've got to go back to our insurance company and find out. When you say you would send the report to MMA, that's our insurance company. So we need to talk with them again. You remember I had that conversation earlier with them, but I hadn't at that point in time thought about community services because we didn't do one this last year. But probably the best route to go is for us to go back and just find out how MMA, through their lawyers, interpret Cape Elizabeth kids going on a trip through Parks and Recreation, but what role does the school system hold in that if there should be some tragedy?
Right, I mean, and just the fact that we, you know, approve the community services budget says that you are in fact, you know, so I mean, this doesn't spell it out that it's not, but it doesn't say, I mean, again, you know, there's a policy that I think maybe it bears some, you know, clarification.
I think so too.
Just for that particular aspect, because we do hear your budget and we approve it. So that would indicate that we would, you know, have to approve these kinds of trips that would fall under this policy. I mean, it almost goes without saying that you, in fact, do fall under this. It would be my interpretation.
So what I'll do is have Pauline check with MMA and see what they can tell us at this point in time around that. Because that's an issue we've talked about several times. And again, it's one thing when we're talking about a high school teacher doing it and taking them through the school system, but we need to get clarification on that as well. So we can get that tomorrow.
Can we also clarify, Alan, how community services is covered under their our insurance policy? Would they, if they do this trip on their own, still be covered as part of the school department?
See, my sense they would, but I think we need to check that out. We need to get those. Oh, Pauline?
Community services is part of the school department because community services falls under the guidelines of the school department. The insurance company is the same for a school, town, which includes community services. It's the same policy. So we're all covered.
Now, my recollection, when we went on the European trip, Pauline did speak with them relative to whether or not it would fall under that coverage, and yes, it would, but they also recommended that we have trip insurance, which we did get in addition to, and that was the process we followed the last time. And I have to say the trip insurance really works. Having gone to Europe and having had two kids back out because of the bombings, those folks got full refunds. When I had to reroute them coming home, we got compensated for the additional cost to do that. So it was an excellent move on our part to have that extra insurance, and we would never go again without it. So it was great.
So then based on that and what Pauline just said, that then any trip that community services does beyond 125 miles would need school board approval.
Okay. Yeah. Going by the policy.
Yeah.
As it currently stands. So that means
we need to take a vote.
It does.
All right.
I move that we approve the trip to Guatemala as described.
Second. Trish, thank you. Any other questions? Seeing none, all those in favor? 6-0.
Great.
Thank you. Just when you think you've got everything figured out on a policy, there's another way to look at it, but I think we've got that clear. So I'm going to suggest that we have a consideration of policy. Oh, no, I'm sorry. We've got one more. Consideration of request from a high school teacher for a leave of absence.
This should be a fairly quick one. Karen Lamb, who is an English teacher at the high school, is taking maternity leave beginning January 12, 2007. It's her intent to take the extended leave for the remainder of the 2006-2007 academic year, returning to teach at Cape High School in August of 2007. So therefore, I need to get approval, and we have begun the stage of advertising to fill that position for the remainder of the school year.
Okay. Do we need a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendation for this leave of absence?
No.
We don't need to do that?
No.
Okay. I'm going to request that we move student wellness, which is a policy for first reading, up as one of the first policies for first reading.
Okay, so that's policy JL, student wellness. This is a policy that the Wellness Committee worked on the past several months, and then we presented it to the Policy Committee. And so the Policy Committee is now bringing it forward for first reading. This is a brand new policy. This is what has been mandated by the federal government as well as state. And I don't know. I mean, should I go over this or do you have? Okay. So, and is there somebody here who's interested in speaking to that?
Scott, he was one of the people that I talked with the other day, and he asked if it was all right if he came to
speak.
Okay,
great.
This is Scott Shea.
Hi, I'm Scott Shea. I teach health and phys ed at the high school with Andrea Care. She teaches majority of the health programs up there. I think when we first saw this, we both had pretty much similar reactions. The reactions we had more or less was, okay, here's a federal mandate for a policy that's going to become another document and just filed away. And so we kind of went through and we did a lot of research, just kind of back and forth, and met And we had a lot of discussion whether or not we want to really take this on and address our concerns, which are many. Number one, it's called the wellness policy, and that was tough for us to get through just by itself because it was federally mandated and then adopted by the state. And when you think of a wellness policy, you think of the total health and well-being of students, staff, and so forth, the district. And this policy really only addresses two aspects of wellness, nutrition and physical activity. And I know that Andrea Kerr, she wanted to be here, and she has another commitment, but she kept coming back to that. She says, you know, as a professional that's been in the business for years and years and years, she couldn't believe that this would get through anybody as a wellness policy, and just the whole perception that you're adopting a wellness policy without even addressing the social and mental health of students, which is a huge concern in our health programs here at the high school. It's not just about nutrition and physical activity. So once we kind of got over that hump, then we started looking at the nutrition and physical activity. And in our district, there are a lot of things we've tried to address over the years. We've had all kinds of different changes in programming, but bottom line, the nutrition probably has the most concern among students as far as the offerings at the cafeteria at the high school. It's come down to a lot of financial decisions between what's offered and the cost. I think it's pretty obvious if you can make $1,000 or so a week on cookies versus maybe having fresh food as offerings and so forth. It was a struggle to get even some of the candy machines and soda machines removed because of the financial profits that they actually demonstrated. So it's not too difficult if any one of you walk in and take a look and listen to the kids. They would much rather have choices that's not there for them. And the things that jump out at them, I think, in the cafeteria, it's hard for them not to grab the candy bars and the slushy machine and the cookies that are sitting there, the danishes and the croissants and cinnamon rolls that are right there for breakfast. That's what you see. And so here we are saying that we want the best for the kids educationally, and I think everyone knows that nutrition activity tie in directly with performance of students. But yet, whenever we bring this up, it's somehow just kind of pushed aside. And we've had wellness committees, we've had a nutrition committee, and those committees more or less were kind of slid aside also as this policy was being adopted. Or at least, I shouldn't say adopted, the policy was actually brought for discussion in the first reading. And as professionals, I think we took that as a little slap in the face that we weren't even asked, do you want to be part of this initial first committee? Another reason why we kind of shook our head and said, how much do we really want to take on or address regarding the first reading here, the wellness policy? So, you know, with what we've seen as far as physical activity, since I've been here, there's been no phys ed in the kindergarten, which when you take the developmental needs of the kindergarten physically and the growth that's occurring, it's amazing to me that parents in the community, Cape Elizabeth, wouldn't want or bring that up as a main concern. But it, again, it hasn't existed. I think I handed Alan and met with our department at the high school a few days ago, and we did quite a bit of research on a lot of the documentation things that are out there, but it's amazing when we're talking all these national standards and so forth and all these other programs, the national standards for physical activity is 150 minutes a week for the elementary students, 150 minutes. For the middle school and secondary, it's 225 minutes a week. That's the national standards. Our students, when you look down through, most of them are getting phys ed one class out of 6 days. So some weeks they don't even meet for 45 minutes. And that one class is 45 minutes. So when you take that into consideration and start saying, we're only meeting, maybe achieving 20% of what the national standards are saying is kind of what you need to have an excellent program for students' developmental needs. So these are things that, again, we kind of put together. And when we first saw kind of what was supposedly the first reading of the wellness policy, we just kind of looked at it like, wow, that's a lot of work. Hopefully that's going to be done, because we hope that this becomes something that does guide us in a direction that benefits the students and their needs physically and nutritionally, and not something that we just say is another federal or state mandate. Any questions?
I don't have a question, but I have some comments. And first, I want to say thanks so much to you and Andrea and whomever else worked with you on
Jake.
Oh, Jake. Okay. I'm reviewing that, and I know that Alan met with people at the middle school, and I think at Pond Cove, too.
Pond Cove people didn't make it the day we did, but I met middle school and high school people.
And so we certainly appreciate your time to look at the policy. You know, just to explain, you may understand, but other people out there listening may not realize that this is actually, we started from a draft that was provided to us from MSMA, which is a lot of times where we begin with our policy work if we're drafting a brand new policy. And we actually looked at documents from probably 10 different states around the country. And that's not to say that this is the best one by any stretch. I think that there's always work that can be done on policy development. But one of the decisions that we had to make was that we realized, we could probably spend a whole other year talking about this wellness policy and broaden it to include the, emotional, psychological growth. I mean, this could go in so many directions. But the policy mandate is that actually schools are supposed to have this in place by September of this year. We're actually one of the few schools in the state that has not yet adopted a wellness policy. And so while we didn't feel that we rushed the work, because we did spend probably 8 months working on this, we did feel that this was maybe a good beginning point, to start. And hopefully, Scott, that we are proposing, and again, one of the federal sort of guidelines is that we, out of this comes an ongoing wellness committee. What we're recommending is that committee become a standing committee of the school board, and we did put together a list of all the different members that may be invited to serve on that committee. And so, this is by no means sort of this is it, this is all it's going to be, but we feel that it's, perhaps a good starting point, because we do need to get a policy in place. But I'd just like to invite are there other thoughts or comments by other wellness committee members? To share?
Well, I'll just say that this is a first reading. So if you have something specific in mind that you would like to see added, I would welcome seeing it. And if it's something that can be easily included, that doesn't have huge budgetary ramifications, I would imagine that would probably be welcomed and accepted. But I would like to reiterate what Ann said, and that is, I do see this as a beginning policy, and as you know, we review policies all the time as a school board, and if the Wellness Committee is approved as a standing committee, I imagine that it will look at the policy, and if they see any areas that need improvement or changes, that will be recommended to the school board to adopt. So. I think there's a lot of amazing, wonderful energy around wellness in our schools, and I look forward to seeing lots of people coming together and working to make this an actuality.
Great. Yeah, I do want to say also, because making it a standing committee, I think, is a great adjustment. I also, appreciate the policy committee going back and looking and saying we definitely want the professionals included in any kind of continued work that's going to be done, and And I do think, you know, that there's the recognition that there are a lot of needs in this area, that specific area that, that we still have. You know, hopefully we'll be able to really focus.
I do want to clarify that it, the policy committee and the subcommittee that looked at this never envisioned it without staff professionals on it. I think what the thought, if I remember correctly, what the discussion was they didn't want to tell the superintendent who and who could not be on it. But then following Alan's meeting with you and others, he felt very comfortable having actually a list being offered as a recommendation. So just so you know,
right.
For me personally, I always envisioned the staff playing an integral role of whatever committee was formed.
Yeah, and just so you guys don't take it personally either, it amazed us. When Andrea and I started looking at all the documentation and so forth, it amazed us. It came down federally, that at the federal level, they wouldn't recommend that the professionals be in on the initial planning of this whole policy. That they only recommended a certain list of people, and nowhere did it say there needed to be any of the professionals working in the school systems, nurses, phys ed teachers, health teachers, social workers involved in the implementation of this policy. So it's amazing, again, at the federal level, that you're requiring all the states to adopt a policy without the professionals having any say. And literally, it could be adopted without any professionals in any school system having any say. You know, and so that's what that shocked us. So yeah, it wasn't, I know that it came down federally, and that was the guidelines you had to work with. So.
One of the ways that we chose to get some input was through the survey that we did last year. That was, you know, to staff and parents as well as students. And that was a more, you know, informal but yet broader representation of, you know, ways of looking at this issue, you know, short of having a committee of, you know, 50 people.
Right.
And I think the message that your group gave to me, which was very good, and also the middle school group gave to me, is the wellness committee itself. There were some comments about there have been this type of committee before, but there's been work that has never been followed through on. And I think the challenge that you gave me that day, and I know the middle school did as well, if we're going to have the committee, let's make it work and do what we need to do, ask specific questions and deal with each of those. And I have given to the members of the wellness committee the minutes that I sent on to you the other day, plus the articles. And so I think, from my perspective anyway, as superintendent, is I need to be sure to build a committee that truly is active and truly brings back to the board suggestions and ideas around phys ed, around health, around nutrition, all of those pieces.
I would like to make a suggestion that the appointment and role of the Wellness Advisory Committee includes three teachers. Can we specify X number of those teachers to be health educators?
Yeah, I would have anyway.
Sure, I mean, we can put anything on this list we want, well, basically.
Yeah, that's the suggestion then, that X number of these teaching positions be actual health educators, including someone we think of as, you know, being in the gym, as well as someone like an Andrea Kayer.
Well, there is, they do designate a position for a social worker, a school nurse, guidance, and then three teachers. So if you had health educator, phys ed, as the other two to round out, representing aspects of nutrition,
I mean, for that matter, we could increase that. You know, we could we could increase that to six. And the other thing is that this
conversation
is
conversation for policy.
But yeah.
The point is that if we specify health educators, then we will be aware in future boards that that's what we have to do.
So I mean, that we can certainly add that.
And the only other comment, Scott, is you know, everyone has been completely right so far. There's a lot of energy around it. I don't think the conversation is going to end just because this policy is adopted. So I would expect that, you know, we'll continue to move on, and your comments are well taken.
And I guess I could suggest that what will happen now is that this will then go back to the, goes back to the policy committee in December to have any more discussion before it's brought back for second reading, and that might be an opportunity, you know, for you and Andrea to come to that policy meeting, and I don't talk about that some more if you'd like to do that.
And even on that, I think if somehow word could get out to the community, because there are community members, I think, that would really like to have some input in this area, and we talked about school doctor and things like that, so.
Right, and that's what that list of, that, then right. That, you know, ongoing wellness committee, when that's right. actually formalized, that's where that would happen.
Okay.
But I'm saying, you know, you would maybe want to come to the next policy meeting where this specific policy would go, right. you know, to be considered for second reading.
Great.
Yep. Scott, when you say members of the committee, are you talking about members of an existing committee or a former committee?
Yes.
That's what I thought.
Yes.
Yeah, that's what Andrea was talking about.
Right. Great, thank you.
Thank you very much, Scott.
Thanks.
Okay. Yeah, thank you for coming and sharing your thoughts on that. And that'll go back, as Ann said, to policy. Which brings us to the top of the list, back to consideration of...
Well, actually, but are we going to, what did we decide that we really wanted to do with the, there was discussion at the policy committee about whether we wanted to tonight for, you know, make a formal proposal to form an ongoing standing committee called the Wellness Committee.
Well, the policy hasn't been adopted yet. It's going back to committee for review. So how do you form a committee from a policy that hasn't been adopted?
Yeah, well, we talked about that too. And we, you know, we said, well, we could wait, or we could just, we know that we're going to have the committee. I mean, sort of regardless of the what direction the policy goes. I mean, it doesn't really matter. If people want to just wait and hold this off until after the second reading and do this in January, or it can go either way. We thought we would just, Rebecca?
I'd like to vote to create it tonight so that it is in existence for the caucus meeting with all new board members that will happen before our next meeting. I don't think we're going to be risking much by voting it as a committee before the policy. The communications committee was created without any sort of communications policy. The committee kind of came up with its own strategies and goals, and then the school board approved it. So I don't see that we're really going too far one way or the other if we just vote to create the committee so it's in place in time to have it on our list.
Are we talking about creating the committee or appointing the members?
Creating a
committee. We have to create the committee.
I have no issue with creating the committee.
Yeah.
My only concern was that until we specifically state, never mind.
Yeah, okay, so if people are okay with that, I guess I'd like...
Yes, you can.
I'll make a motion that we form a standing board, a new standing board committee called the Wellness Committee, to be comprised possibly of the members listed on this, but it's not limited to that. Right, can be revised.
Second. Any questions, Trish?
Just to clarify, on this, in this policy, it's a wellness advisory committee. And I think when we went through that whole board organization, it was standing advisory and ad hoc. So is this
standing? So when we talked,
so this is going to be different.
Yeah, this is going to be different. This is at what, when we talked about this at the policy committee, we discussed that we thought maybe this should be a formal standing committee.
Okay, so that will change the language in this document.
In the policy.
Okay.
Which is why Alan put in your board packet the handout on board standing committees.
Any other comments or questions regarding this motion? All those in favor? We have 6-0.
Okay, so the next policy for consideration is IKFA, which is early graduation. And there are just, well, you can see it's in red, the change that's being recommended from our current policy. So this is just first reading. Are there any questions or thoughts, concerns to take back to the policy committee for discussion? Nope. Okay. And the next one is IL, evaluation of instructional programs. Again, just one suggested change. Any thoughts or questions on that one? Okay. Next is ILD, student surveys and marketing information. Any thoughts on this? The next is IMDB, flag displays. Just one change on that. Questions, thoughts? And we did student wellness. Then Cape Elizabeth. Actually, there's a name. Yeah, that's the wrong name. And where? Receiving, KCE, Receiving Education Foundation Funds. This is a new policy. Any thoughts on this to take forward to the policy committee?
Does it meet the requirements of the law?
I don't know if there are laws around this. Are there, Alan?
I think what we looked at is what we're looking at this to do is just to open the door for these educational foundations, et cetera. So I don't think there was a law question, as I remember it, at the time. It was just a matter of how we open the door for that.
Okay. So there's been no discussion of fiduciary responsibilities?
No.
Okay.
Okay, and then the last one that we added is EFE, competitive food sales. That wasn't in your packet, but I handed that out. And this was one that, again, came through the wellness committee and that the policy committee just looked at today. And so we decided that we would, since we were doing the other wellness policy, we would bring that forward tonight. So we understand that some of you who were not at the policy committee today have not had a chance to see this prior to tonight, or if you weren't on the wellness committee. Any questions on this or thoughts to take back to the policy committee? No? Okay. And I believe that's it. Thanks.
Thank you, Ann. Item 11H, consideration of recommendation from the Personnel Committee.
The Personnel Committee met on October 19th and went through a lot more job descriptions this time. We're trying to get our manual done as quickly as possible. Those under consideration tonight, do you want me to take them one at a time or all together?
Okay.
All right.
Quickly down individually, just if there's any points I think that you need to make about.
Okay. Food service director, we took this back to committee, had some discussion around the separation of some of the duties and responsibilities. Most of the discussion on that came back to, this is a job description. This doesn't necessarily apply to a particular individual, but it is a job description. And as part of the food service director, all of the responsibilities that are encompassed here are part of their responsibility, whether they're actually doing the duties themselves or not. They're still responsible for all those duties being performed, because that was a question that came up at the last board meeting. There is one change there that we made, and that was on number one under performance responsibilities, and it had to do with plans and supervises the preparation and serving of the meals at all schools, making certain the food served is of high nutritional value. That's the only change since the last meeting. Okay. Any questions or anything like that? The next one was the Pond Cove teacher leader. This was a new position that was created this year. Worked very closely with everyone to write up the new job description. And again, we're trying to just keep all the formats the same and consistent. Any questions? EdTechs 1, 2, and 3. Dominic did all the work on these to make sure that we had everything in there that we needed to meet all of our state and federal requirements. So thank you, Dominic, for presenting us with such a nice format. And the last one was the volunteer coordinator. And again, most of the work on this one had to do with just making sure all of our format was remaining consistent for all of our job descriptions. Can I go ahead and make a motion?
Yeah, and these went before?
Personnel.
Personnel.
And we're bringing them tonight for approval by the full board.
And the actual individuals in the positions, did you get feedback from them like you had the other ones?
Not specifically. A lot of these job descriptions were already in place. We did have some of the directors go through them, such as Sue had gone through all the food service director to make sure that there were a lot of the responsibilities and so forth that had to be covered. As far as the EdTechs 1, 2, and 3, again, I would want to turn that over to Dominic. He did all of the work on all of those.
I did meet with all the ed techs individually, so I grouped it in Pond Cove and the middle school and the high school and did get feedback on all three positions and discussed most of the job descriptions. They had a lot of questions around twos and threes in particular, and so we try to clean that all up. So, but we did get feedback on most of that. So.
That's what I was, I just knew that was a sticking point at one point. Right. So.
Yeah, it's pretty clear now, I think, okay. in the new job descriptions. So.
Thank you. Thanks.
Anything else? I'd like to move that the Cape Elizabeth School Board approve job descriptions as described.
Second.
Thank you. Any further comments?
Thank you. That's really great to see all of this done. I really feel like a lot of progress was made in this area, so thanks to the Personnel Committee.
All those in favor? 6-0.
Going along with the job descriptions, we're also working on getting together all the evaluation forms for employees district-wide, including community services. And bringing forward tonight evaluation forms for bus drivers, staff employee evaluations, and custodial evaluations. And again, I need to thank Sue Weatherby for all of her hard work on this as far as incorporating a very similar format. We're trying to keep things relevant to the specific positions. That was one thing in reviewing some of the evaluation forms that we have seen. They didn't always apply specifically to employees in different areas throughout the school district, so that's what we're trying to do, is make the evaluations actually fit the job descriptions, at the same time keeping them in a format that's going to flow evenly between, you know, department to department, so that everyone is being evaluated on a basis fair to their job level. So I would like to, anybody have any questions on any of the information that's in any of the forms here? So I'd like to make a motion to approve the employee evaluations forms for bus drivers, employee staff, employee evaluations, and custodians.
Second.
Kevin, second?
I'm sorry.
No other further questions? All those in favor? 6-0. We have committee reports. We'll start off with Rebecca, please, with Finance Committee.
Okay, we met Tuesday, October 24th, 12:30 in the superintendent's office. Myself, Kathy, Linda, Alan, and Pauline attended. We signed warrants.
We were informed that a price of $2.01 was locked in for 135,000 gallons starting in January. At that time, the cash price was still under $2. Fuel was budgeted for this year at $2 a gallon, so we're in pretty good shape with keeping within the budget for this year for our, at least for our fuel. Food service report was reviewed. The level of negative student accounts is at a low point despite a slight increase from the end of last school year. There are about 15 families with balances over 40, and there are only two with over 100. So we were in pretty good shape. We did look at the appropriations report. Is that correct? Yeah. And there was just a couple of things that we looked at. One was the advertising budget. There's a little bit of concern because back in October, we were already at 84% of the budget. And we know we have a couple more positions that had to be advertised, and who knows what's down the road. So there was a meeting of the town council and school board chairs and finance chairs. Among the topics that were discussed was just a preliminary discussion of a normal budget process and what it might look like should Tabor pass. There was also a brief conversation about the possibility for a joint school municipal effort in looking at alternative energy for Cape Elizabeth. We're hoping to have a follow-up meeting, hopefully in December. The committee received information on the status of Alan's and Pauline's 07-08 budget efforts, building on existing zero-based budgeting for the district. And we saw a sample form that will be used, a draft timeline, and a summary of the discussions that Alan and Pauline have had with DLT. And as you may know, I did write an article for the Courier to let people know that this was an area of work. And our next meeting is set for November 28th at 12:30. And it should not say, my notes say join the conference room in Alan's office.
Any questions? Thank you, Rebecca. Policy Committee, Anne.
I don't really need to say too much because now that we're doing the policies first, that certainly shortens the committee reports. However, there is just a couple things. We've met twice this month because we had to move up the November meeting because of the holiday. But I just want this somehow noted that, because it wasn't presented earlier, policy IKFC, I just don't want this to get lost somewhere. Is that we did review that, and no, we're not recommending any changes. So, Mary, we just need to be sure to have a change on the bottom of that policy that it has been reviewed. You know, in November or October of 2006, so that, you know, 5 years from now, people can know that it was reviewed. And there are a couple of other ones, too, that would normally be, you know, under next month's, I guess, board meeting. But I just, you know, again, I just don't want these to get lost because there are three policies. The policy committee also met today. Normally, we would have been meeting next week. But there are three policies that are not going to be, you know, no action will be required because they were just reviewed and we just want it documented that there will be no changes. And those are DF fundraising, CB school superintendent, and CA administrative goals. Because those would not be under any new business.
Yeah. Oh. Fundraising, I thought we made one change. That sentence.
On the policy?
Oh, it was administrative guidelines. Yeah. I'm sorry. The policy was...
Yeah, because we made a lot of changes on the guidelines.
Right,
So those will be presented next month.
The idea was that fundraising was going to come from co-curricular anyways.
No, this is a separate... No, this is a whole separate policy. Okay. Yeah. I just, you know, want to be sure that it's documented somewhere because it won't be under new, you know...
Yeah.
It won't be a first reading or anything. But it needs to be on the bottom of those policies. So, anyway. And there are some other policy that will be presented next month for further consideration and changes, and people can present those then. And then the Wellness Committee, I was going to give a report on that, but again, I think we've already gone through the policies, so I don't really think that there's anything further I need to say on those.
Thank you, Ann. Rebecca, back to you for communications.
We met on October 24th. It was Trish, myself, Mary Page, Margaret Welch, and Alan Hawkins. Alan checked with Mary and Margaret for feedback on the superintendent monthly letter to staff. Both shared that it was a welcomed way of being kept informed. Alan also gave the committee the report on the VUE status, which I don't think I need to go in because Alan's already discussed that. Then we spent the majority of our time discussing methods of sharing between staff professional development experience, sharing of staff professional development experiences to enable a greater return on our investment and to create more opportunities for cross-building and cross-program discussions. And as a result of that, there is a space on the website where staff professional development summaries will be posted with some insights and hopefully summarizing at least three interesting insights, new approaches, and or content areas. So hopefully this will really, I'm really excited about this because I think it does kind of magnify the benefit that we get from paying for professional staff development. We do have a meeting scheduled, but I don't remember what it is.
December 13th.
Thank you. It's December 13th at 3:05 at the Pond Cove Media Center. Any questions?
Rebecca, could I just tell you that that site, on the, it is already on the website, and we have, I think, four workshops posted already.
Oh, great. So check it out.
Okay. Linda, you're reporting for personnel?
Yes. Personnel held their regular meeting on October 19th. Alan, Kevin, Kathy, Ray, Colleen, Elaine, and myself were present. Most of the discussion evolved around the superintendent's evaluation at that point in time. A form was presented, discussed, and distributed to the individual board members at that time for them to complete. We then scheduled two other meetings, both executive sessions, the first of which was the board getting together to discuss the evaluation and to compile the data. The second meeting was with Alan to review the results of our compilation of all the data. And at the same time, there was also a form made available to all, any and all staff members throughout all of the school for them to include their feedback. In addition to that, we went through several job descriptions and evaluation forms, as we've already covered tonight. Our next meeting is scheduled for Friday, November 30th at 10:30 in the Jordan Conference Room.
Thank you, Linda. Strategic planning, Trish.
The committee met on October 30th, and we received an update from Alan on sort of the subcommittee's work on the staff day that will take place on November 20th as we're the board's re-examining and recommitting to the future direction plan and the long-range plan for the school district. Heidi McGinley, who's a facilitator that's working with the district, also proposed or presented the process by which we're going to bring reevaluate the mission and vision and bring it ultimately to adoption by the school board. We talked a little bit about the November 28th school board workshop, which will be an opportunity for the public to learn about the process that's been ongoing and also to express in their opinions on the mission and vision. And we talked about the third step at this point that's sort of on the docket for planning for when we would have another workshop that would build on information and data that was collected in November 20th staff day as well as the workshop on November 28th. We do not have another meeting planned at this point as we were going to see the results of the three meetings at this point that are scheduled. I think the third meeting is January 26th, which is also a no school day for students, but for staff.
Thank you. The last committee, student extracurricular. Kevin?
I've already covered most of what happened at our last meeting in the earlier business, and it just revolved around endorsing the sailing club so that they can compete under the high school's name. The rest of the discussion revolved around sports done right and the need to either get on with it or drop it. We have at this point extended invitations to outside sports groups to participate in the December 11th training program up in Orono. That invitation is also extended to everyone on the board, everyone who will be on the board, as well as all of our health educators, and so on. We'd like to get as many people interested in the concept there as possible. We recognize, thanks to Rebecca, that some of our people from outside groups will be working, and if we're given any indication of that we will be moving forward, we will see what we can do about bringing that training session to Cape Elizabeth. Our next meeting is on December 5th at 2:15 in the student superintendent's office. That's it.
Thank you for all the committee reports. At this point, I open up the podium for any public comment at this time. Seeing none, are there any school board agenda requests from fellow school board members for the December meeting? Seeing none. Announcement of upcoming meetings. We've gone through some of these. I'll try to get them correct, make any changes if necessary. Policy committee is not set for Tuesday, November 4th. Oh, that was today.
That was today. Both of
yep, that's been done. And same as strategic planning. Personnel committee was set for Friday, November 30th, 10:30 a.m., Jordan Conference Room. Student extracurricular committee, as Kevin just said, is December 5th, 2:15 to 4 p.m. That will be in the superintendent's office. Finance committee meeting, Tuesday, November 28th, 12:30, superintendent's office. We have a school board workshop, which the topic will be the future direction plan. That is scheduled for Tuesday, November 28th, 7 p.m. in the high school library. The communications meeting is December 13th at 3:05 in the Pond Cove Media Center. And finally, our next school board business meeting will be Tuesday, December 12th, 7 p.m. right here in council chambers. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Thank you, Kevin. Second?
Second.
All those in favor? 6-0. Thank you, everybody.
I just realized that this is